This is Duke University.
Thank you. Grace and peace to you in Jesus Christ our Lord, and welcome to this service of worship today. Happy Pentecost. Today is the day that we celebrate the birthday of the church throughout the world and celebrate the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We wear red as a sign of celebration and joy and the Spirit's presence. And this morning, many of the children and parents of the congregation will be participating in a festive procession during our opening hymn. Today is also the first Sunday of our chapel summer choir. And if you have ever wanted to sing in a choir or be part of Sunday worship, you are all invited. There are no auditions. It is not at all scary. The dates that the summer choir will be singing are listed in your bulletin. So look at those dates, and if you'd like to sing, all you have to do is show up at 9:15 that morning. We'd love to have you part of our worship. I'm also very pleased to introduce today's guest preacher, Dr. Anathea Portier-Young. She is associate professor of Old Testament at the Divinity School next door and is a very beloved teacher and scholar. It is a real Pentecost gift to have her in our midst today and to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to us through her. And now, come, Holy Ghosts, our souls inspire, and lighten us with celestial fire. Let us stand and sing God's praises.
We've called on the Holy Spirit to come, inspire our souls, and illuminate our sight. In the Spirit's light, we see the truth of our brokenness and sin. Let us confess our sins in the confidence of God's mercy and grace through Jesus Christ. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God's grace has been shed abroad in our hearts. Let us now share words and signs of this grace and peace with one another.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. Holy Spirit, sent by the Father, open your words to us and ignite in us your holy fire. Strengthen your children with the gift of faith. Revive your church with the breath of love and renew the face of the earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Genesis, the 11th chapter. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as they migrated from the east, they came upon a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, "Come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly." And they had brick for stone, and bitumen for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we shall be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth." The Lord came down to see the city and the tower which mortals had built. And the Lord said, "Look, they are one people, and they have all one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do. Nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language there, so that they will not understand one another's speech." So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore, it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of all the earth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The New Testament lesson is from Acts, the second chapter. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly, from heaven, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how then is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages we hear them, speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks.
Thank you. The gospel lesson is from John, the 14th chapter. Philip said to Jesus, "Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact, will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you." This is the word of the Lord.
Seated. Pray with me, please, from Psalm 104. The earth is full of your creatures, Lord. When you give to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are filled with good things. When you send forth your spirit, they are created and you renew the face of the earth. May my meditation be pleasing to God, for I rejoice in the Lord. Amen. We gather today. We are all in one place together on the Feast of Pentecost. Pentecost, this festival known as Shavuot, or weeks in the Hebrew tradition. This festival sanctified in the shared life of God's holy people, handed on to each generation in the books of Exodus and Deuteronomy, and in the celebrations of this pilgrim feast. 50 days earlier, God's people celebrated Passover, remembering their life on the run, remembering the miracle of their freedom from slavery. And with that feast, they also witnessed the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The 50 days between Easter and Pentecost are days of growing. They are days of maturing. For the first followers of Christ and the other Jews of their time, Pentecost was the day that God's people gathered to celebrate the harvest, the fruit of what has been planted and nurtured. And before tasting the bounty of that harvest, they bring their first fruits and their first loaves to God's holy temple to give thanks for the blessings God has rained upon them and the blessings God has caused to grow from the earth. On this festival day, God's holy people have made a pilgrimage to offer these gifts back to God. And one more thing about Pentecost. The 50 days of Pentecost mirror the 50 years of the biblical Jubilee. The biblical Jubilee is a year of restoration, freedom, and salvation. Pentecost sets God's people in motion toward the salvation of all the earth. And on this Pentecost day, says Acts chapter 2, they were all together in one place. Jesus has ascended to heaven, and the last words he spoke to his followers before he was lifted up were a promise. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses throughout Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. A group of followers, about 120 men and women, we are told in chapter 1, are gathered now in the upper room and waiting for this gift. They're gathering for this feast, and the gathering of their fellow Jews in Jerusalem testifies to a further hope, a hope for the unity of God's people, a hope for the ingathering of all who have been scattered, captives, soldiers, exiles, refugees, migrant workers in search of labor and food. Israel's prophets foresaw a future when God would gather in God's people like the harvest and make them whole. But it is not yet time for the gathering in. The followers of Jesus begin together in one place, and they begin speaking one tongue, and they begin, we are told, sitting down. And then the Holy Spirit comes in. It comes in when they don't expect it. It comes in suddenly. It is loud, impossible to ignore, with a noise like a violent wind, just like a wind that could tear the roof off the house and send the people inside spinning to the ends of the earth, like a wind that could overturn tables, breathe new life into God's people, and renew the face of the earth. The Spirit comes in like a wind that will knock down walls and start mixing people up. It fills the entire house that holds them, every room, every corner, and then divided tongues appear. They are like fire, and in a brief moment of stillness, those tongues sit on each gathered person, each of these 120 men and women. Divided tongues. I want to stay with this phrase for a bit because it's a strange one. Let's start with the first word. What does it mean that these tongues were divided? We hear this word and we start thinking mathematically. We start thinking that when you divide a number, it gets smaller. But here's the thing. We aren't talking about a number. We are talking about the Holy Spirit. We are talking about the infinite power and wisdom and saving love of God. These do not diminish. There is no greater or less in the Holy Spirit. And when we track the root of this word divided, in Greek, the word we have here, diamerizomenai, we track that through the scriptures, we find it has a different connotation, really. A form of the same word, diamerizo, appears again later in this same chapter of Acts, in verse 45. And there we are told that among these first Christians, there was no one in need whose need was not met, because this community held their possessions in common. And it says, they divided them among them all, each according to their need. Dividing their possessions made possible a koinonia, a sharing of gifts and blessings to meet the needs of all. And this passage sheds light on the connotation of this word and suggests to us a less poetic but more accurate translation, distributed. Tongues distributed to each and to all. And I can't get past the implications of this word. Just as there is not a person in the community of these first Christians who has a need that is not met, there is not a person in this house who does not receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This gift passes no one by. When Peter explains to the crowd outside what has happened to them, he says that what has happened in this house is what is written in the book of Joel. The prophet Joel declared that this Holy Spirit would be poured out on all human beings, sons and daughters, young and old, slave and servant, so that all begin to prophesy, behold visions, and dream dreams. And Peter now proclaims, this is what has happened. These days have come. The Spirit has been poured out upon us. And he tells the people outside the house, people who weren't there inside when the Spirit came down, that through baptism, you also will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. It is for you, and it is for others, those who are near and those who are far away. Because this is the Spirit that comes in like a violent wind, ready and able to break down the walls and blow the roof off the house. This gift of the Spirit can't be hoarded or contained. Now the second word, tongue. When we visualize this scene, we usually picture a flame, because the scripture says it is a tongue as of fire. But can you hear that it doesn't say it is a flame? It says it is a tongue. A tongue is an organ. It is a muscle. Okay, technically, it is a muscular hydrostat with no fewer than 8 muscles that allow it to change shape and position. And this supple, shape-shifting, hydraulic muscle system is a sensory organ that helps us to taste and to savor, to gain knowledge about the world around us and about that which nourishes us and keeps us alive. This tongue will give us knowledge and wisdom and insight about the Word of God and about the world into which and the people to whom this word has come. And this tongue makes it possible for us to speak, to declare God's word with clarity in plain language that all can understand, to testify out loud to the forgiveness of sins, to bear public witness to the resurrection of Christ Jesus. Now, what does it mean that this tongue is as of fire? We know that it's not a flame, it is an organ of sensation and speech, but it is like a fire, because these tongues have the power to ignite human hearts and minds and to spread until the whole world is blazing with the vital heat and light of God's word. And these tongues as of fire settle in, but they don't settle into a place. They settle into people. And that means they are going to move. So when the Spirit decides to settle in, look sharp. Some exciting things are going to happen. God is going to move things around, and God is going to move you. God is going to empower you and enlist you, and you are going to change the world. If we look forward in the book of Acts, we learn more about this gift that God gives when the Spirit comes in and the tongues take a seat. It is a gift for healing, for comfort, for peace, but it is also a gift of boldness and courage to testify before tribunals, governors, and kings. The ones who first received this gift were, we are told, ordinary people. They did not hold academic credentials, but they became teachers and preachers who would not be silenced. Authorities bound them and flogged them, and commanded them to stop teaching in Jesus' name. And they declared their obedience not to human authority, but to divine authority. And they rejoiced in the Spirit, and they kept on teaching. When they preached in public, there were times when the men in the crowd very deliberately took off their coats and carefully stowed them, because they had decided they needed to move their arms freely so they could kill the one who declared the resurrection of Christ. And in the face of such danger, the Spirit's gift of boldness led these followers of Jesus to keep preaching, even when it meant their death. Time and again in the book of Acts, we read that those who received the gift of the Holy Spirit and proclaimed the gospel of Jesus Christ were persecuted. And when they were persecuted, we are told, the Spirit did not draw them together for safety and protection, did not gather them in. The Spirit scattered them And with this scattering, we become mindful that the dividing of tongues holds one other meaning. Those who receive this gift begin to speak in different tongues, the languages of the earth. And with this detail, we hear an echo of the first occurrence of this word divided in the Greek Old Testament, the Bible of the New Testament writers. That word divided has its first occurrence in Scripture in Genesis chapter 10. After the flood, when God has commanded the children of Noah to fill the earth, there in chapter 10, we read of 70 nations, 70 peoples descended from the children of Noah, each with their own families, their own tongues, their own lands and nations. We read that the earth itself has been divided, and the very plurality of these peoples and tongues is a hallmark of God's blessing. It is also a sign that they have fulfilled God's command to spread throughout the earth and care for its welfare and that of its creatures. But in the very next verse, in the passage you heard from Genesis 11, something has shifted, or we have moved backward in time. For the families of the earth are not scattered. They do not have different lands, and they do not have different tongues. The whole earth had one tongue and one set of words. This one-tongued people migrated from the east away from Eden, and they settled in the plain of Shinar, and there began to build a city and tower so that they would not be scattered over the face of all the earth. This city building, this tower building, answers no call from God, conveys no blessing to the earth and its creatures, and so it neglects the commission God has given to all humankind. So God distracts this one-tongued humanity from its single focus, its narrow ambition, its tower to the sky, by turning one into many. God introduces differences so great that peoples can no longer understand one another, and God scatters them over the face of the whole earth. These echoes reverberate in the passage we heard from Acts. On the day of Pentecost, Jesus' followers begin all together in one place, and then the Holy Spirit comes in. The Spirit fills the whole house in which they are sitting, and divided tongues as of fire settle upon each one of them. They are filled with the Holy Spirit, and they begin to speak in different tongues, and yet they have power now, ability, capacity to speak plainly. It is the opposite of the confusion of Babel. It is purposeful speech. It is clear speech. It is speech that knows the divisions between us and yet is not afraid and is not confused. And we have heard that these people who gathered in one place, as you have today, who sat in one house, as you do now, would not stay in this one place for long, because the Holy Spirit does not stay still. The Holy Spirit moves, and the Holy Spirit spreads and scatters and sends. We call Pentecost the birthday of the church. We know it best as the day the Holy Spirit came down and filled the house and filled the people in the house. Today we are in that house, and the Holy Spirit comes down and the Holy Spirit fills us. And so I warn you now, tongues of fire have descended even upon you. You have already received this gift. You are called to see and to speak, to heal and to set free. And so it is time for you to prophesy. It is time for you to declare the gospel. And if you think that is not your calling, think again, because this is the gift of our baptism, and these tongues pass no one by. The Spirit has a plan. The Spirit is going to set you in motion and spread you and scatter you. The Spirit is sending you. For Pentecost is above all the day of commissioning. It is the day when the church, this church, receives its mission to be witnesses to the resurrection of Christ, the forgiveness of sins, and God's work of salvation.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Sending Father, you poured out your Spirit at Pentecost and set ablaze the hearts and minds of your disciples. By that same Spirit, draw us together, set our hearts on fire, and fill us with your love. Inspire in your people the light and joy found in life with you, that those all around might be compelled to know you. Make your church a beacon of your holiness, your universal love, and your truth. Draw near to those who are leaders within the church. Give them wisdom and humility as they walk after you. We remember any who've been wounded by those bearing your name. Be near to all for whom the church has not been a place of hospitality or welcome because of differences in race, nationality, sexual orientation, or social or economic status. Hold close to you those churches and faith communities within Durham, working together for the peace and well-being of all the people of our city. Lord, in your mercy. Giving Son, you promised that the Advocate, the Spirit of truth and life, would come after you. Fill us with the living waters of the Spirit. Quench the thirst of all who are physically in need today. Be the living water that abundantly meets the needs of those with the most precarious life situations. Guard and protect those in Durham who have been victims of predatory lending and who find themselves crushed by financial debt. Give grace to those who live in shame or dread or fear because of their financial situation. Send waters of peace and protection in places where violence is more consistent than food and water. Send waters of healing and reconciliation to any in broken relationships or marriages. Mend relationships between coworkers, neighbors, friends, and families that are cracked and dry. And make the waters of your spirit flow through your people, that the world may know your refreshment and life. Lord, in your mercy. Spirit of unity, the scriptures remind us of the gift of language, and they caution us how words can be used for good or for ill. Mend the divisions caused by language and other communication barriers. Where literal and metaphorical walls separate us from one another, blow through us as a violent wind, that we may be united with one another. Be close to the immigrants and migrant workers within our community, and remove the boundaries that keep us from seeing and knowing one another. Restore those displaced by the violent rushing winds of the tornadoes in Texas in recent days. We remember those who've lost homes and livelihoods in the floods of the Midwest in recent weeks. Reveal your hope when all seems lost and despair is threatening. Distribute your life and light and truth to us all, that we might proclaim your word wherever we are without fear, that your love may be made known in all the world. Lord, in your mercy. O God, who on this day taught the hearts of your faithful people by sending to them the light of your Holy Spirit, grant us this same light, that we might rejoice evermore in the Spirit's holy comfort, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Kristen Westfall, a Chapel Pathways scholar, will be sharing with us our mission announcement this morning.
Amani is the Swahili word for peace. Amani Children's Home was founded in 2001 to provide care for six street children living in Moshi, a city at the foot of Mount Kilimanjaro in Tanzania. These children were living on the street primarily due to the ravages of HIV/AIDS and intense poverty. Amani, once directed by Duke alumna Valerie Johnson Todd, now provides housing, education, healthcare, and other support services to more than 250 children. Amani Children's Home is not an orphanage. It strives to reunite children with extended family members, giving kids the chance to spend the rest of their childhood in a safe and loving home. If the family cannot afford to feed and educate the children, Amani will then assist. All of the proceeds from today's offering will go to Amani Children's Home. Please give generously. Amani be with you.
May the Spirit inspire you that your giving would glorify the Lord.
Thank you.
Using communion setting E, found on pages 24 and 25 of your hymnals. And if you are here today with a person or an issue weighing heavily on your heart, ministers will be in the memorial chapel to my right during the sharing of communion, and they will be glad to pray with you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. God of surprises, your spirit brooded over the waters at creation and lived among your chosen people in wilderness, exile, and promised land. Your spirit filled Mary's womb at the moment of Jesus' conception and came upon him like a dove at his baptism. On the day of Pentecost, you sent your spirit upon the fearful disciples, filling them with fire, with power, with wonder and joy, and making them your church. And so we gladly thank you with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, singing the hymn of your unending praise. God of comfort and strength, we look to your Holy Spirit to be with us in sorrow and in contentment, in crises and in abiding stillness. Come among us now through the power of your Spirit, that we may be transformed into your image, and that these gifts of bread and wine may become for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Who on the night he gave himself up for us, took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. God of dreams and prophecy, send down upon us your gifts of wisdom, knowledge, and faith, of healing, discernment, and interpretation, that your church may be built up in the likeness of your Son. Let anyone who is hungry find in you the bread of life, and anyone who is thirsty find in you rivers of living water. Speak your word to all who are alone and in fear or despair, and let each one of your children hear your voice in their own language, whether that language be art or science, work or play. Sanctify your groaning creation, that your universe may breathe your breath and be filled with your life anew, that we may love what you love and do what you would do, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, ever one God. We are bold to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Come, Holy Spirit, and make Christ present in the breaking of bread. Join the banquet of the Lord. Come and feast at this table. Please stand. God of earth, wind, and fire, we bless your name this day for sending us light and strength through your Holy Spirit. We name before you administrative professionals whose attention to detail and management of office life undergirds and gives strength to the whole of this university's life. We give you thanks that we have been swept up into your abundant life and for the beauty in ordinary things. Transform our lives by your Spirit as you have transformed bread and wine at this table, that our ordinariness becomes a sacred and holy gift. Faithful God, who fulfilled the promises of Easter by sending us your Holy Spirit and opening to every race and nation the way of life eternal, open our lips by your Spirit, that every tongue may tell of your glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now may the Spirit of the living God descend upon you, filling you with love, power, righteousness, and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you always.